Hello, and welcome to the How It's Made and Director's Commentary for this video, the Unseen Side of Speedrunning, where I combined all of my attempts to beat Super Mario Bros. In under 5 minutes. So I'm going to try and answer some questions, clear up a few misconceptions, and talk a little bit about the future of this technology and this channel. The quick answer to how it was made is that over the course of the year, I wrote a program to help me do it. And here it is. So this is the program that I use, that I wrote to help me combine all of them together. And there's a lot of pieces around. It's kind of messy. You can think of it like the jigs or scaffolding that a more, you know, conventional artist might use when they're making things, so it doesn't have to be pretty, and it just, and all of these little pieces just kind of have to get some kind of job done. But this main view here, these are the actual frames. So this is the video that we watched all kind of put together. And just to give an example of one of the things that I can do with this is I can click on one of the Marios, and it brings up this sort of information here, which might be a little hard to see, but this Mario here that's just falling into the pit on frame number 2923 was my 1,190th attempt. It happened on May 30th, and yeah, of course, his cause of death was a pit. But I can pull up, for example, the actual video that this came from here on the left. This is the actual video from that day. And on the right is the reconstruction of the information within that frame. So I can just scroll through it with my mouse wheel and we can see kind of the video on the left and my reconstruction of it on the right. So let's look at another example. Our best friend was here, the guy who does a little wall jump. So like we can scroll through the video and see him go. There he goes down and he pops back up. So if you couldn't see him, he's down here, down in the kind of bottom left area. And if we click on him, so that was attempt number 176. Oh, and he also died by falling into a pit, but he did it much later. So we can pull that up, we can see what happened to him. So if we watch what happens, he jumps out of the pit and goes on throughout the rest of 4-1 and into 4-2, but it looks like here he meets his demise. Yeah, so he falls into this pit. So what frame is this on? So this is frame number 7046. So if we go to 7046, in the actual video. So I'm sure if you watched the video and you saw this guy down here right by the timer fall into the pit, that was our wall jump hero. That's where he died. So I don't think it would be too interesting to go through everything here. There's a lot of stuff. Some of it was more useful than others. But like, for example, if we just come back to say a frame right around, you know, right around here where we have at least some sort of interesting stuff on screen. I can show you how this part was, at least how these sprites were identified. So this screen shows kind of a debug view of what's going on. So it kind of highlights different things so I can see where I am in the world, and it highlights the different sprites. How we actually classified that was right about here. So on the left is the frame from the video, and let me run it. Okay, so on the left is the frame from the video. In the middle is the actual classification of the different sprites, or at least where it thinks sprites are. So these brighter spots here are where my code thinks the sprites are. And if I put my mouse over it, it tells me what sprites it thinks are there. And then on the right-hand side, it shows what it actually determined is in that location. So it was right. And of course, it does this through a series of fast Fourier transforms, our best friend. Okay, let me clear up a couple of basic misconceptions. So first of all of these attempts are me. They're all mine. They're not everyone else's. I do have plans to combine the top 200 or so runs on speedrun.com into one video. I think that would be really cool. But there's issues with video quality and stuff, so that might take a little bit. So all of these attempts are just my own. Another misconception, the final time, this guy, this highlighted Mario, It's not the world record or really even that close. So I don't do any of the much harder tricks like flagpole glitches or bullet bill glitches. And my 8.4 is okay, but it's definitely, and it, like it has the wall jump, but it's definitely not the cleanest 8.4 either. So 4.58, I think, is a good time. I'm proud of it and I'm happy that I got it, but there's definitely a lot of room for improvement. And hey, maybe a follow-up video with that. The other thing to say is that all of these attempts are only attempts from the start of the speedrun. Over half of the footage, here they all, 415 videos, about 120 gigabytes worth. Over half of this footage was actually practicing individual levels or individual tricks. And those, of course, didn't make it into the actual video because they didn't start in 1-1. In fact, I spent most of my time practicing 8-1, which was particularly tricky. Okay, the other misconception is, of course, it's not fake. It's just, and another thing, it wasn't done on an emulator, although I really should have done it that way. It would have been a lot easier to use an emulator and keep track of the relevant memory addresses for like where I am in the world and what's, and the object attribute memory for what sprites are on screen, instead of having to pull it out of the video afterwards, especially dealing with like different video quality and that sort of thing. It would have been much faster, much easier, much more accurate. And that was just because I didn't want to have to play with a keyboard. I thought it would be fun to play with the controller and on the original hardware. And I thought that would be, I could just kind of make up for any differences with code. And I did in the end, but it would have been a lot more efficient to use an emulator for sure. A few more things. There was a lot of people asking about grabbing the top or the bottom of the flagpole. It is faster to grab the top. Here's a little clip. And some people were asking about why there are gaps between the Marios, and it is because of a system called frame rules. And it's like this door is open for Mario to come in all the time, but this door only opens every 21 frames to let Mario out. So it ends up grouping them all together. Another thing a bunch of people were saying is that I had a 0.23% success rate. And I would really say it's more like 0.04% success rate, because only two of the runs I would really describe as a success. My first run where I made it to the end without dying, that was definitely a success. And then the 4.58, that was the other success. Also, a bunch of people gave me stress for dying to this first Goomba so many times, and I guess, yeah, I did, but sometimes you're just holding B and right, and you're not totally paying attention to the level starting when you're doing it 5,000 times. Some people asked me why, and I guess the main reason was because I thought it would look cool, and it seemed like it was going to be a fun project. It seemed like it would be a little challenging to program, but ultimately a relatively quick thing, and although that ended up not being the case, it was very difficult in the end, I still think it did sort of look cool. And here is actually my original notes for the project. And what I told myself was I wanted to create a video demonstrating just how hard it is to beat NES Super Mario Bros. In 5 minutes. I wanted to record every single attempt, edit them together to play on top of one another, compute stats and stuff, have a voiceover describing the tricks, and make the video interesting. And I think I did four of those. I didn't end up doing the voiceover because I didn't feel like it was necessary. And of course, I had to have this admonition to myself, which I think I kind of did okay with, but not great. It's pretty tricky to make something like this and to balance getting the video done and writing good and reusable and fun code. So prior to this project, my greatest gaming accomplishments were probably that I beat I Wanna Be the Guy back in university. I spoke with Bennett Foddy at the top of his mountain once, and I got Diamond very briefly in season one of StarCraft II when everyone kind of sucked. I'm sure I'd be bronze today, but I'm by no means a speedrunner. So when it came to Mario, I hadn't really played this Mario too much before going into it, and I figured that that would kind of make it interesting because we would see the very first attempt. And if we actually go back here, we can spot him. He is right there. Oh, yes. Actually, let's pull him up right here. So this back here on the left, this pipe, this guy right here, he was my very first attempt. So here's the video on the left of my very first attempt. So I didn't start running right away. Not a great strategy if you're speedrunning. And I went down the wrong pipe here, or at least tried to. And eventually I died rather unceremoniously to a Goomba by jumping up into it in 1-2. So a good place to start. But you know, hey, we all start somewhere and then eventually we get to where we want to go, right? So I had to learn how to speedrun Super Mario Bros. And so for that, I used this tutorial from Cosmic. I did also watch Darbyan's and I picked up some tips here and there from other places, but really I followed the route in this tutorial. And I think I got about everything in this video, except my 8-4 was a little sloppy. If I had to give any advice about the actual mechanics of speedrunning, I would say that you should practice more than I did. I knew that I was recording the videos, so I knew that attempts would end up in the video, and it would be cool to have more Marios running, but I think I would have improved faster and got the time that I wanted faster if I would have practiced the later levels more. So a little bit more information about how I actually worked my way through the videos. So I had to classify all of the individual frames into a number of different buckets to really know what was going on. So in the video, was I playing the game? Was I on the title screen? Was it in between different like resets? I would sometimes get these color bars. Was I on the title screen? And like, was it blue or whatever? So I had to classify the frames. And for this, I used a rather straightforward convolutional neural network. I also had to classify any text on screen. So the zeros, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. And with that, I was able to tell what world I was in and then what level in that world. So that was really important. And with those two classifiers, I was able to write a auto splitter, and the auto splitter would go through the videos one by one and split them out into different attempts, into the 5,000 plus attempts that I ended up using. I did extract all of the frames from the videos as individual PNG files, which I ultimately would say was a mistake. It would have been better to leave them in the videos and just decode them as necessary, because moving around 16 million different frames was not super fun. I did have to get the data for the Super Mario Bros. In order to reconstruct the scene. And for that, I used the copy NES. Here's just one picture of me installing it in the NES. Because I don't know of any other ways of getting the ROMs for these games. You know, you really gotta get them yourself. The next task was for each of those frames to figure out where in the world it was. So where am I? If I know I'm in 1-1, where am I in 1-1? Or if I'm in 1-2, where am I? And this was kind of complicated because there are some duplicate locations. So for example, in 4-1, this very screen shows up twice exactly. So it was a little tricky to figure out where exactly I was in the world. After that, I had to figure out what was on the screen and where it was. So where is Mario? Where are the different Goombas and the Koopas? And there's a lot of stuff that could be there. I was originally going with a neural network for this as well, but ultimately I ended up using, like I said, template matching or fast Fourier transforms to find everything. So you might also be wondering about what the future of this technology is, and I'm not totally sure. I have plans to extend it to other games and other contexts, and I think it would be really cool to see this technology used to combine races live. I think that would be super fun, and if you want to be a part of that happening, then stick around.